Drainage is artificial removal of water in excess of the quantity required for the crop. Drainage includes removal of excess surface and subsurface water in the root zone. Irrigation and drainage go together and are not mutually exclusive. Irrigation system aims at supplying optimum quantities of water throughout the crop period. Drainage system aims at removing excess quantity of water in a short time. Often, both may be required together to assure sustained and high level production of mulberry crop. Excess water causes great harm to the crop by reducing availability of oxygen to the root system and accumulating carbon dioxide and other gases harmful to the root system. Drainage of excess water from irrigated fields is necessary for satisfactory growth and yield of mulberry crops. In parts of West Bengal and Assam, where rainfall is heavy, drainage is necessary for rising paddy crop. There are areas where crops cannot be sown in proper sowing time because of standing water on the fields or excessive moisture in the root zone of the crop unless efficient drainage is provided. Not only accumulated surface water due to heavy rainfall or flood, but also excess water in the field due to over irrigation or seepage from adjacent canal or distributor and percolation of irrigation water from the fields has to be drained. History of drainage. The practice of land drainage is also ancient but was evidently viewed less important than irrigation. Greek historian Herodotus, who lived in the 500 BC, referred to drainage in the Nile Valley. About 200 years later, Cato, the elder of Rome, described drainage practices adopted in eastern countries. The first drains seem to be ditches or canals built to carry flood waters back to the rivers. The first known use of tile drainage was in 1620 in France. Drainage in irrigation projects. In the planning of most of the existing irrigation projects in our country, provision was not made for adequate drainage in the command area. Water table has built up steadily due to high seepage and percolation losses consistent over irrigation, spillage from canal system and not using groundwater. Water logging and salinization have thrown considerable acreage in the command area out of production. The importance of providing adequate drainage in command area of projects needs no emphasis. For efficient working, irrigation canals have to be designed and constructed such that full supply level is above ground level. Causes for water logging. Water logging is caused when inflow into groundwater exceeds outflow from it. The problem is serious when hydraulic conductivity of the soil is less than 2.5 cm per hectare. Heavy rainfall and over irrigation in humid regions are the main causes for water logging. In the river basins and deltas, when there is high rainfall, water is not drained fast due to low elevation and flatness of lands adjacent to the sea suffers from water logging by the ingress of sea water during high tide. Low infiltration rate of the soil. Vast areas in the deltas of Gangas, Brahmaputra, Godavari and Mahanadi are waterlogged. Seepage from reservoir with large water spread and canals running over long distances. Over irrigation and non-provision of drainages in irrigation projects has led to water logging. Floods in rivers spread to cultivated land during high storms and cyclones and causes water logging. Overland flow, underground seepage from adjacent areas, etc. causes water logging. Effects of water logging. Water logging is generally defined as the condition where water table is less than 3 meter from the surface. At this depth, water from the water table rises at significantly rapid rates by capillary action to the ground surface. The following are effects of water logging. 1. Water logging reduces soil aeration. This results in reduction of oxygen supply to the root system of the plant. There is also a buildup of carbon dioxide, methane, ethane and propane in the soil, which are harmful to the root system. Root damage is the final result of the prolonged water logging. Oxygen concentration in the soil atmosphere is about 17 to 20%, and when it falls to less than 10% due to displacement of air in the soil pores by water, growth of the plant is inhibited. 2. Due to anaerobic conditions in the root zone, uptake of nutrients is affected. 3. Due to restriction of root growth, the volume of soil tapped by the plant roots for nutrients is restricted. 4. Due to capillary rise of soil water by evaporation on the surface of the soil, salts are brought to the surface layer and salinity results. 5. Soil temperature is lowered, soil structure is destroyed and bearing capacity of the soil is reduced. 6. Plant nutrients are lost through leaching and water flow. 7. Yield of crop is reduced or even zeroed. The average loss is yield varies from 20 to 100%. Excess water in the crop root zone soil is injurious to plant growth. Crop yields are drastically reduced on poorly drained soils, and in cases of prolonged water logging, plants eventually die due to a lack of oxygen in the root zone. Sources of excess soil water that result in high water tables include high precipitation in humid regions, surplus irrigation water and canal seepage in the irrigated lands, and artesian pressure. Water logging in irrigated regions may result in excess soil salinity, the accumulation of salts in the plant root zone. Artificial drainage is essential on poorly drained agricultural fields to provide optimum air and salt environments in the root zone. Drainage is regarded as an important water management practice and as a component of efficient crop production systems. World food supply and the productivity of existing agricultural lands can only be maintained and enhanced if drainage improvements are undertaken on crop land currently affected by excess water and high water tables. Drainage, both surface and subsurface, is not simply the conversion of wetlands but the improvement of naturally inadequately drained cropland. It is complementary to irrigation and is viewed as an essential component of irrigated agriculture. The objective is to increase production efficiency, crop yields and profitability on naturally poorly drained agricultural lands. To remove excess soluble salts with excess water from drained soil profile, to maintain groundwater levels at a desired level, is to enhance crop growth and to maintain the soil productivity, to remove excess surface and subsurface water. Advantages of drainage system. Draining the land provides conditions favorable for high crop production. The greatest benefit of drainage relates to aeration. Good drainage facilitates the ready diffusion of oxygen to the root zone and escapes carbon dioxide from the root zone into the atmosphere. Several harmful gases also escape from the root zone into the atmosphere. The activity of aerobic organisms, which influences the availability of nutrients such as nitrogen, and sulphurous to plants depend on soil aeration. If oxygen is present in the root zone, toxicity in the acid soils due to the excess iron and manganese is decreased. Drainage permits roots to grow deeper and spread wider, thereby increasing the volume of the soil from which nutrients can be extracted. The removal of excess water helps in warming of the soil quickly, and optimum soil temperature permits timeliness of field operations. The provision of a good drainage system permits the removal of excess salts if they are present in the soil or irrigation water, and prevents their buildup in the upper soil layers. Reduces the effect of droughts and excessive water from heavy rains or snow. Increases the temperature of the soil, which loses its heat to excessive surface water. Improves aeration and the nitrogen content of the soil, which results in earlier germination and better root development. Removes toxic material and disease organisms. Reduces soil erosion by creating better root systems. There are two general types of land drainage systems. One is surface drainage, which removes excess surface water from the fields. Second one is subsurface drainage, which removes excess water from the crop root zone depth of the soil. Surface drainage. The method of disposal of excess water depends on the type and magnitude of the drainage problem. A slope of free water surface is developed for removing excess water from the land surface to an outlet. Surface drainage not only includes removal of excess water by land grading or smoothing or field drains, but also by diversion of water so that it does not reach the area to be protected. The latter includes diversion, ditches, dikes, leaves and floodways. Interception drains. Drains are excavated across the slope on grade to intercept and remove surface runoff to protect the area which receives overland flow from the surrounding areas. Diversion drains. A channel is excavated across the slope to divert runoff and subsurface flow from upper reaches entering the area to be protected. Based on the area to be drained and maximum intensity of rainfall expected once in 10 years. The size of the diversion drain to take care of all the runoff from the area draining into its calculated. Bedding system. The bedding system is adopted when the slope of the land does not exceed 0.5% and is slowly permeable soils. Parallel beds are developed by shaping and smoothing the surface so that runoff drains laterally from the beds into dead furrows created in the same location each year by flowing. Dead furrows lead runoff into cross slope collection ditches and finally into an outlet ditch. Random system. When only potholes in the fields are to be drained, they are connected to each other by a ditch and then finally led into a lateral outlet ditch. Parallel drain system. In this system, the ditches are at right angles to the field drains and are uniformly spaced. This system is suitable when the surface is flat or uniform and has a few ridges and depressions. Field drains. The field drains collect water from crop rows on the land surface and remove it to lateral or collecting ditches, which drain into a main ditch or directly into an outlet. The field drains are usually shallow and about 22 to 45 centimeter deep with stable side slopes. The ditches should have adequate capacity to carry all the drainage from the area draining into them. They should have the cross-sectional area to remove at least 5 cm of water from the area in 24 hours. The spacing of the drains depends on soil and topography. Usually, they are spaced about 120 meters apart in clay soils and about 300 meters apart in sandy soils. The lateral and collecting ditches are deeper and bigger. Choice of suitable outlet is very important in any drainage system. Success depends on the choice of the outlet. The ditches require periodical maintenance for proper functioning. Silt has to be removed and vegetation in the ditches has to be suppressed. Subsurface drainage. Difference in hydraulic head are developed for removing excess water beneath the soil surface. The resulting hydraulic head causes water to move through the soil to open or close drains such as tile drains, through which water is conveyed by gravity to an outlet. Till or pipe is the common material used for subsurface drainage. In areas of high rainfall, intensity and when heavy over irrigations are common, the water table rises very rapidly in the root zone. The drainage system has to lower the water table fast enough to prevent damage to the crop. A study of the falling water table in the drained land is therefore necessary. Several formulae relating to the rate of fall of water table to the system, geometry and soil properties have been worked out. Before laying out the drains, their carrying capacity, drainage coefficient, depth, spacing, slope or drains, soil and plant characteristics have to be studied. The most common subsurface drainage system at present is till drainage. Pipe or till drainage. Pipe drainage removes excess water from the soil through a continuous line of pipes laid at specified spacing, depth and grade. About 90% of the underground drainage system installed today is by the use of perforated PVC pipes instead of tills. Water moves into the pipes through the perforations and is then channeled to an outlet ditch. The extent of area to drain in, till line length, slope and drainage coefficient determine the diameter of the till to be used. Tills of 10 to 30 cm diameters are used. The till length varies from 360 cm to 600 cm. Slopes vary with environmental conditions. Grades vary from 0.15% for 10 cm diameter pipe to 0.05% for 30 cm diameter pipe. The flow velocity of 30 cm to 45 cm per second is maintained to carry the sediments getting into the pipe lines. The pipe should be placed at 60 to 70 cm below the soil surface. Special care is necessary to protect the pipe outlet. A flap gate to prevent entry of rodents is necessary. A flood gate is necessary if there is danger of flood water entering the pipe. It is desirable to lay out long and straight lateral pipelines. The length of mines should be minimum. The layout of pipes can be of several ways. Number 1. Gridiron. This method is used when the land is uniformly wet and slopes in one direction. There is one main to which many lateral are fed. The laterals are laid only on one side of the main. Number 2. Herringbone. If the land slopes from both the sides and the line in between is a depression, this method is adopted. The main line is located at the depressions and the lateral from both the sides drain into it. Number 3. Other types. There is other type of layouts of pipelines such as double main, natural, diagonal, mixed, etc. depending on the topography of the land area to be drained. Drainage well. Water table also be lowered by drainage wells. A deep and uniform soil without imperfections layer not obstructing free downwards movement of water is suitable for drainage wells. The wells may be gravity wells located in an confined aquifer to remove water directly from the root zone. Wells may also be to tap an aquifer holding water under pressure. The pumped wells can be the most feasible approach to drainage and reusing the water for irrigation. The drainage wells should be far away from canals. A drainage system consists of following elements. Number one is field drains. Field drains herewith only consider subsurface pipe drains. Control the water table and collect the excess water in the soil or from the groundwater and convey this drainage effluent towards the collector drain. Number two, collector drains. Collector drains can be either open or piped. Open drains convey rain and groundwater towards the main drainage system, and piped collectors only convey the drainage water from the field drains towards the main drainage system. Number three, submain and main drains. The main drainage system, which consists of several submains and a main drain, conveys the drainage water from the collectors towards the discharge site. Main drains are normally open drains, although theoretically these main drains can be pipes. The required diameters are generally very large and therefore profitably expensive. Then discharge site. The discharge site or outlet is the terminal point of the entire drainage system from where the discharging is done into a river, lake or sea. The outlet can be a gravity outlet structure or a pumping station. A gravity outlet structure is a drainage structure in an area with variable outer water levels where drainage can take place by gravity when outside water levels are low. In delta areas, drainage by gravity is often restricted to a few hours per day during low tide. In the upstream regions of river, drainage by gravity can be restricted for several weeks during periods of high river discharges. A pumping station will be needed in areas where the required water levels in the drainage system are lower than the water level of the river, lake or sea. A subsurface drainage system is used in soils that are permeable enough to provide an economical installation. If the spacing is too narrow, the costs will be excessive. If the spacing is too wide, crop yields will be reduced. The soil must also be productive enough to justify the investment. Moreover, since a subsurface drainage system functions only as well as the construction of the outlet, it is important to make sure that a suitable outlet is available. A drainage system should be well planned and properly installed. The permeability of the soil should be assessed. Ditches and subsurface drains should be located and spaced properly. Because minor elevation changes are involved, a topographic survey is often required. Installation equipment is available today to place ditches and sub drains with a high level of accuracy to ensure proper performance. A drainage system that has been properly planned and installed will function as intended for many years.